Anytime God is trying to do something new inside of your life, it's always going to be uncomfortable and unorthodox in the beginning.
Come on now.
If you notice, the more and more they started singing, you could look on their faces and you could be like, they was looking at each other like, what pastor going to go with this? They thought I was going to sing, and they was worried, and you could see all of that. But the more and more they started settling in. And so what I want you to know before we separate is that when God is calling you to do something new, it's going to take beyond crazy, because you got to get comfortable in what is new. And what ended up happening is, as they begin to be uncomfortable, God will never leave you stranded and or by yourself. Because as they were sitting there struggling, I don't know if you heard it, but Brother Rudy was picking them up on the keyboard. Now understand, we've never had a keyboard player. So in order for us to do something new, to get something new, we got to walk in new areas. Now, some of you was looking up there talking about, you know what, they sound crazy, look crazy, and I don't know what's going on. But there was a few of you, there was one or two of you that said, you know what, I see they struggling. Yeah, yeah. I see they not sounding how they should sound, so let me help them out.
Come on now.
Come on now.
Let me help them out. Let me join in with them. I know the words to the song. I don't sound like they sound, but I can help them out.
Come
on now. What I'm here to tell you is, when you're trying to do something new in your life, not everybody's going to be there with you. Woo. But God will have at least two or three to support you.
All right.
Right now.
Come on now.
Come on now.
Rest of you kingdom, y'all can go over. But I'm here to let y'all know today, it's going to take beyond crazy. I know when I left out of the house this morning, my wife, she really didn't look at me too good. I just heard her say, hey, Willie, it's not casual Sunday. And soon as she said that, I said, you didn't look at me too good, did you? She said, no, I just saw you from the back. She probably was looking at this nice gluteus maximus that I have. But, and it can get distracted. But here's the point that I'm making. When she finally looked at me, she said, oh, something wrong with you. I said, okay, it's part of the message.
Amen.
I walked in, thankful Sister Andrea and Sister Pamela and Rudy, they was here, and they looked at me and they were like, Pastor, you okay? Yeah, I'm fine. Sister Tanya said, Pastor, she was trying to be polite. She says, what's that hat? I know that wasn't the first thing that she saw. I say, it's part of the message. Because here's part of the message. It's going to take beyond crazy for you to be a true child of God.
Yes.
A lot of times we settle in to status quo. A lot of times what we try to call to be different ain't necessarily different. It's crazy. You look at me and you're like, hey, Pastor, something wrong with you. And why do you think something is wrong with me? Because what you normally see of me, that you don't see today. So evidently, if you don't see what you normally see, that means there's something going on. Now I'm about to talk to us Christian folks. We as Christians, we spend a lot of time trying to let people know that we are Christians. We spend a lot of time trying to get an understanding to let somebody else know that I am saved, I am anointed, I am a man, I am a woman of God. But the problem that we have with that is we look crazy, but on the inside we know them. We put on, that's where all these Jesus Freaks t-shirts comes in. We do weird things. We get tattoos all over our bodies, and we talk about our temple, and we wear all kind of weird clothing. Why? Because we are trying to draw attention to ourselves so that people can say, why you look the way you look, why you talk the way you talk, so that we can in return tell them about Jesus. I'm here to tell you, we got it backwards. We shouldn't look crazy on the outside, but we should be crazy on the inside.
Amen.
We should have things on the inside that is reflective of the things on the outside. And we get, as a matter of fact, let me digress here for a minute. Usually we'll stand for the reading of the word, but you all stay seated because I'm going to read a little bit and I want you to get some points because I'm going to go through these scriptures. Amen. But if you're following along, turn in your Bibles to Isaiah chapter 64. Isaiah chapter 64. And when you have it, say amen.
Amen.
Back in the old days, I would have been like, man, we got a lot of Bible scholars. Because that was quick. But then I had to just take for a quick moment. You got Bibles on your phone.
Yes.
Chapter 64 of Isaiah, starting at verse number 4. It says, "For since the beginning of the world, men have not heard, nor perceived by the ear, neither have seen, neither have the eye seen, O God, beside thee, what he hath prepared for him that waiteth for him."
Wow, that's good.
One of the problems that we have in this generation, one of the problems we have in this life, is the microwave. The microwave is one of the worst things ever invented. I know you sitting there saying, "Pastor, you must be crazy." I know the young people are saying, "Pastor, I don't even know what you're talking about." What I'm talking about is what the microwave has done to this world, has made us crippled. You ask somebody, "Hey, go cook me some bread, some eggs." They're going to toss it in the microwave. Now, companies have made millions of dollars by, instead of telling you how to cook, they have already pre-cooked that bad tasting food, put it in some plastic container, and put some instructions on the top that says, "Lift the lid, heat, and in the microwave for 5 minutes." We heat it up for 5 minutes, and guess what? Then we put it on the table and we eat. It's called TV dinners. Everything can be put in the microwave. What has the microwave done? The microwave have taken families out of the kitchen. Microwaves have taken families from sitting down and eating at the table together. Why? Because when your kids say they're hungry, what do? You tell them to go downstairs, teach them how to dial it to 3, 4, or 5. They go do it, sit down, and feed themselves. Now, what am I saying? Am I really saying that it's that bad? No, I'm not saying it's that bad. It can be, depending on your household. But what I am really saying to you is the microwave was the start of making a generation and a group of people who want things instantaneously.
That's right.
It was the start of something that has caused us as Christians to develop bad habits. Now when we pray to God, we want instant success. We want instant promise. We want instant blessings. This has even hurt the offering plate. I'm not up here trying to preach or teach you how to get your money in the offering plate, but what I am saying is that a lot of people put their money in the offering plate today and expect some kind of reward and or blessing tomorrow. That's why the scripture says it right there. You haven't heard nor have you seen the things that God has for you, because it requires patience to be a Christian. Anything that is worth anything in life, it requires us to have patience. You're going to taste the best tasting food, it takes patience. Anybody ever had something fried? It's quick. Tastes good, but when you know how to put it in a crock pot, when you know how to put it in a slow cooker, and you just let it sit there and marinate all day, all night, and the seasonings just start infiltrating into the bones and infiltrating into the meat, and then the seasonings get in there, then your mouth go to watering, and then when you pull it out, it just falls all off the bone. Then that, when it falls off the bone, y'all might not understand it, but then it makes something that they call instant gravy. So now you cook 2 meals. I remember one about a week, 2 weeks ago, my wife cooked some stuff in the crock pot. You know I'm sounding crazy. I said, "Leave the meat and give me the gravy." It was just that good. I didn't even want the meat. I just wanted the gravy. Why? Because when you do anything, let me put it in ways that we can understand. We got adults in here, and I hope we got some kids that's probably watching online, but I'm here to let you know right now, when the intimacy between a man and a woman, do you want it quick, or do you want some time to start building up? You understand what I'm saying? You want some things to start happening. You don't want things in life just to be always quick. You want to put some time into some stuff. So why is it that you want to put some time into you, but you don't want to put no time into God? Amen. You got to wait for some things. You got to marinate some things. Can't just be rolling up there on God on any kind of way. Oh, Lord, I need this, I need that. Bless this, bless that. And most of the time you go to God, it's for selfish gain anyway. Because if you're a true man and woman of God, you already know, as long as I take care of him, he gonna take care of me.
Amen.
But you know what we get in trouble with? We get in trouble because we take care of God the way we want God to be taken care of. And that's not the way it should be done. I can always relate it back to a relationship. You want somebody to love you for you, or you want somebody to love you because of how they want you to be loved? That caused problems in marriages. I remember my wife and I, we first got together. And you know, when you get engaged, you're supposed to talk about rings and different things of that nature. You know, you get rings and things. And so I already knew how my wife was. I said, hey, she wasn't made no bones about it, about who she was, and what she expected.
Amen.
So I said, I'm gonna do the brave thing. I say, Lord, I'm going to go get my wife an engagement ring. And you know, that's a dangerous thing, especially when you're dealing with somebody who knows what they want, when they want it, and how they want it.
Amen.
And if you don't give it to me that way, then you might as well just take it back. It's just, it's wasted.
Amen.
So I went before the Lord, and the Lord showed me something. Long story short, I gave it to her. She said, what's her name? I said, who? The woman that helped you pick this up. I was like, you know, woman helped me pick this out. It was nice. She enjoyed it. But she got me something nice too, though. And when I didn't respond the way she wanted me to respond, I had to explain some stuff. Because she got me a ring. It's nice now. But it wasn't nice to me when I first got it. It was a nice, big, fat ring. It had like 5 fat diamonds in it. Oh, it was nice. I was like, because I'm a simple kind of person. Well, I'm a simple kind of person. And so she had to learn that. But then let me tell you something about God. As time went on, though, I started noticing some things. I noticed when I wear bands like this, I get a regular handshake. Hey, how you doing? Whatever. When I wear the band she got me, hey, I get treated a whole lot different. People treat me like I got status. And I'm like, hey. So what's the moral of the story? You may not like it in the beginning, but hold on. When you start seeing the benefits, some of God's gift, you just got to grow into. It ain't always about what you think or what you feel, because you don't know you like you think you know you. And this is why we miss out on a lot of blessings from God. It's because we think we know us, so if it don't come the way we want it to come, then we're not going to receive it. And guess what? We get left out.
Right.
It's going to take something beyond crazy. It's going to take something beyond crazy. Let us go on. Verse number 5, 6, and 7, 8. Thou meetest and rejoice and worketh righteousness those that remember thee in thy ways. Behold, thou art wroth, for we have sinned. In those continuance we shall be saved. Verse 6. But we are all as what? An unclean thing, and our righteousness are as what? Filthy rags. We all do what? Fade. Let me let you know something about fade. Fade is not a drop off. This is why we think we're saved one day and we wake up 2 weeks later and looking at ourselves and say, how did I get in this position? Because you start to fade. That's the biggest trick of the enemy. You fade. You think something is okay, but you start to fade. You start to wander in the background. But it says we fade as a leaf, our iniquities like the wind have taken us away. There is none that calleth upon the name that stirreth up himself to take hold of thee. For thou hast hid thy face from us and hast consumed us because of our iniquities. But now, O Lord, thou art our Father. We are the clay, thou art the potter, and we all are the work of thy hand. This is why we shouldn't judge people. This is why we shouldn't cut people off. Because every person you come in contact with is the work of God's hand. We are clay. You know what that means? He is not finished with me yet. The man that you see standing before you today is not the man that you're going to see standing before you next week, should God tarry that long. Why? Because we're all should be being worked on. We all should be worked on. Let me tell you why that is such an important scripture. It's an important scripture because if you ever think about the most priceless things in life, the most expensive thing you can buy is crafted with your hands. That's labor. You can think about it. Think about anything that you can think is expensive. The more someone put a personal touch on something, the more expensive that it costs. Why do you think cars are so expensive? You look at the most expensive cars, they're not made on assembly lines like normal cars. That's why it's only so few of them made in the world. You look at a Chevy Ford, Chevy Mustang, they're expensive because they're rare. Not everybody can afford it because of how they are made. You look at the Bugattis. These are some expensive. Why are they so expensive? Because they are handmade and they have more parts to them. So that means they're more expensive. Why? Because more TLC was put into that. What I'm saying to you is that your life is so valuable that God sculpted you by hand. There is only one of you that has ever been made in this lifetime. That's how rare you are. And the more rare you are, the more expensive you are. Amen. You must understand your value. Amen. We are all the workmen and the handcraft of God. Amen. We are not God. We're just handcrafted by God. You must understand that no matter what the darkest hour is in your life, God created you by hand. So he will not let his creation fail. He loves us too much. We just don't love ourselves that much. You know how you don't love yourself that much? Because you don't want to do what he say do. You don't want to live how he say live. Most of us in here got kids. How do you think you feel? You've been working 14 hours a day, 20 hours a day. Going off on weird jobs that you really don't want to go off on to provide a roof over your head. And your child turned 18, 12, 10, 9, and they look at you and say, you are a failure. I can do better by myself. Do you understand the disrespect and loyalty that you feel towards your child? Now, hopefully you ain't never had your child say that. We've never had one say that, but I know they think it. Yeah, whether you said it or not, I know they think it. I can do better by myself. I use my family as an example. I use my son. Josh woke up one morning and felt like he was just king of the world. He had a couple of issues with his mom, and he said, hey, Dad, I'm going to leave. Or I say, hey, bye. But when you leave, take whatever you can't put in this bag, you can't take.
Amen.
But it's mine. Who bought it? See how that worked? He wanted to take his PlayStation, and I know how much that costs, the games. You want to take, no. Whatever clothes you can put in there, we borrow them. You can borrow them. When you get your job, bring them back. But Dad, what y'all going to do with them? Give them away.
Amen.
We bought it. So he tried, and he went away. What it was, left me the 3 weeks, first lady. Mm-hmm. About 3 weeks later, he's standing at the door. Dad. No, call. I will come back home. Well, where you at the front door? He came in. He would cry. Had tears in his eyes. I said, Josh, what's wrong with you, Dad? We almost died tonight. What? or I went with some friends, and they got into it with each other, and they started fighting, and everybody pulled out guns and was going to shoot each other. He said, Dad, it looked just like the Westerns. They all was pointing guns at each other. And I said, well, where was you? He said, I ran. I was on the other side of the car. I said, why did you do that? He said, I ain't have nothing to do with that. And the friends that he was, they came to him. Why you wasn't there? He said, no, y'all stupid. I ain't had nothing to do with it. I'm not finna die over something I ain't have nothing to do with. Then that just came home. Yeah, hey, I'm sorry. I'm gonna be all right. We ain't had no problems since. Why? Because what you start to understand when you start facing real life is that you don't understand the protection that is over you. And most of us don't understand that as long as you stay under the safe haven of God, He's going to protect you from things that you don't ever have to see.
That's the truth.
You don't have to experience everything in life. Jesus was never blind, but healed a blind man. He was never lame and healed a lame man. So I refuse to believe, in order for me to understand what you're going through, I got to have been there. God forbid.
Amen.
What I need is a relationship with God.
Amen.
And the stronger my relationship is with God, then the better I'm going to be. It's going to take something more than crazy for us to make it. Let us go to Acts 17. I'm going to read this real quick. I'm halfway through. Acts 17, verses 1 through 8. When you have it, say amen.
Amen.
1 through 8.
1 through 8.
17.
Acts 17.
Amen.
Verse 1. It reads as such. And when they had passed through Amphipolis and Apollonia, they came to Thessalonica, where there was a synagogue of Jews. And Paul, I need everybody to say this with me. As his manner was. I get asked all the time, are you from the South? Are you from the South? I say, yeah. A lot of them say, is it because of my accent? Most of the time it's just, I always say yes ma'am, no ma'am.
Jamaica.
Pretty much, sir. Or Jamaica. I ain't never been asked about Jamaica. I've been asked if I knew some Jamaica. But what I'm saying to you is people can tell pretty much about you how your mannerisms are.
Yes, sir.
Right.
They can tell you what part of the earth you're from just by strictly your mannerisms.
Right.
And what did Paul? They said, as his manner was. That means that was something that he'd done consistently. And what did he do? It says that he went into them. He went into the Jews. And it says he was there for 3 Sabbath days and reasoned with them out of the scriptures. And 3 Sabbath days mean it was 3 weeks. Verse 3 says, opening and alleging that Christ must need have suffered and risen again from the dead, and that this Jesus whom I preach unto you is Christ. And some of them believed and consorted with Paul and Silas, and of the devout Greeks, a great multitude of chief women, not a few. But the Jews which believed not, moved with envy, and took unto them certain lewd fellows of a baser sort. I could spend all day just on that alone. But and gathered a company and set all the city on an uproar and assaulted the house of Jason, and sought to bring them out to the people. And when they found them not, meaning they weren't in Jason's house, they drew Jason and certain brothers unto the rulers of the city, crying, these men have turned the world, what? Upside down, also come hither also, whom Jason hath received, and these all do contrary to decrees of Caesar, saying that there is another king. Everyone say, one Jesus.
One Jesus.
And they troubled the people, the rulers of the city, and they that what? Heard these things. I just sped read through that. We are almost finished. You know, I'm always going to give you 5 points. Here's point number one. It's not your gift. It's the use of your gift.
Uh-huh.
Everybody been gifted, but not everybody uses their gifts. See, this is the problem that we have. That's why I look crazy. You understand what I'm saying? I look crazy. Because I'm trying to draw your attention. I'm not crazy, but I look crazy. Holes in my jeans, wrinkled up shirt, If I dressed like this on a regular basis, nobody would ever say a thing. But this is not how I normally dress. Got my little hat on, cap. Got my little U.S. Navy shirt, you know. Crazy. Do you understand, Elder Wong Chau, if I showed up to a uniform inspection looking like this? Trouble. That's good. I would get drug tested. Because just because I have on a captain's hat and a Navy shirt does not mean I represent the values, not just of a Navy personnel, does not mean I represent the values of a Navy captain. What am I saying to you? Just because you call yourself a Christian, does not mean you represent the values of a Christian. All of us got a responsibility. And we got to uphold those values. The uniform don't make a man. The man makes the uniform.
All right.
And when we start to understand that as Christians, then we won't be so apt to be trying to draw attention to ourselves. We'll be more apt to just do the job God called you to do. That's what we are about. I would love for this place to be packed out from the beginning to the end. But if God can't fill this place, it can't be filled. This is why we ever have visitors. You don't see me standing up here, oh, well, you know, saints, I would just like to say that I pray for everybody because we got one sister who is, she done flew to the East Coast. We got another family who's sick and on bed rest. We got another family. Do you understand? You know what I'm really saying? I'm making excuses on why the seats ain't filled. Because I'm here to tell you right now, if 10 people that ain't here today, and that makes the difference in our service, ain't nothing wrong with the 10 people, something wrong with us. Because that means we trying to preach to fill the seat. No, let the seats fill because we got something that we can offer the people.
Amen.
We can give them something that they can take away from here and use it in their everyday life so they can be a better man, better woman, better child than they were in the day they came. It's not your gift. It's the use of your gift. Do you understand that if I can make an NBA football season, I'm almost guaranteed I can go and get 12 people to play football that's not in the NFL that is better than the people that's actually playing in the NFL. But you know why they're not in the NFL? It ain't because they don't have the gifts. It's not because they don't have the talent. They don't know how to use it. Or they take it for granted. They don't want to practice. Anybody ever follow the NBA, they understand Allen Iverson. Practice? Mm-hmm. Practice? Man, we're talking about practice. Practice? But if you ever heard him in his Hall of Fame speech, one of the most humble speeches I've ever heard somebody give, you want to know why? Because when your gift is past its expiration date, you start to feel remorse. You start to feel sorry for yourself. You start to say, I should've, I could've, I would've. You start living with regret because you understand I could've done some things better. That's every human in here. I guarantee you right now, I don't care how old you are, take a quick examination of your life and tell me you don't have no regrets. Tell me you can't look at your life and say, I shoulda, coulda, woulda. Somebody told me, and if I woulda listened to this person or listened to that person, then whatever my life is today, it would be even better. I don't know how y'all lives are, but I know this much, however it is today, it would be better. If I would have just lived my life on some of the five principles that my parents gave me, I know I would be further off. My dad gave me some of the best and dumbest advice all at the same time. And this is exactly what he said to me. And I know some of you done heard it before, but I live on this because I wish I would have listened. This was his financial advice to me. "Hey boy, if you can't afford it, don't buy it."
Right.
What? Well, what sense do that make? I got a credit card, a checking account. What do you mean? If I don't have it, now I'm a little older. I know exactly what he meant. And if I would have ever listened and followed that advice wholeheartedly, then I wouldn't be worried about certain things today. Or whatever I have, I would have more of. That's why it's not about the gift. It's about the use. That's why the old saying goes, what's the best ability? Availability. That's the best of the ability available, is being available. There's a lot of people you know can do some stuff, but they ain't never around to do it. What's the use of having it? They can't even serve us nothing. Yeah, we get it all the time. My wife will tell you, we get musicians, "Hey man, we'll come play for you. We'll come play for you." You know what the next thing come out of their mouth is, you know, "We charge a hate." So when you say that, you keep on rolling. It ain't that we don't want to pay nobody to play. I understand certain things, but I always ask them this question. How is it people complain about pastors getting paid, but it's okay for musicians? You know musicians don't really do that much. They really don't. I know they big in the music ministry. I'm not downgrading the music ministry. They practice, they pray, they fast, but it's all just for this. That can affect this. But whatever you put the music ministry over, you multiply that times 40, and then you got the pastor. But they don't want to come play because you don't want to get them $125 a week. Because I'm sitting here thinking, I said, well, look, how about this? I give you $125 a week, but everybody in here pay me $125 a week just to show up. Yeah, ain't that funny now? You see what I mean? That's just how we think. It's not about the gift. It's about the use of the gift. Anybody know us know we generous people. We ain't going to rob nobody. We ain't going to hold nothing from nobody. If you're worthy of something, we're going to give it to you. But don't walk in here thinking you doing us a favor. Because you're not. And I'm here to tell you, I don't care what gift you got on the inside of, don't think you're doing God any favors. Because as soon as you think, without me, they can't do, amen, your replacement is on the way.
That's right.
Amen.
Yes, you have put in an instant request to be replaced. Because the only person that's in charge is God.
Amen.
That's the only person. That's why it's not about your gift. Your gift is not the source. Your gift is a resource. Your gift is just a resource. You know why your gift is just a resource? Because whatever you think you're gifted in today, keep using it. You know what you're going to find out? He's going to have you stop doing that and do something else.
Right.
Give you an example. David, man, I love David. I don't love David for most people. Most people love David because they say he was a worshiper. You know, most people love David because he was a great king. You know what I love most about David? He had the ability to expose himself. That's what I love most about him. He was an adulterer, he was a murderer, he was a bad father, he was a bad husband. Listen, y'all can love David all you want, but I promise you today, if David was living today in the world of Instagram and Twitter and Facebook, there's no way you would love David the way you love David now. I mean, the only thing he could get right is serving God. Everybody else, he failed. Oh, and the king, he never failed King Saul. He never failed King Saul. But everybody else, his wife, his children, the people, his army, he failed all of them. But here's the thing about David. He kept it moving. David was one of the most beautiful harp players. The Bible says he was a harp player. Let me tell you the difference between David and the rest of us. David knew he was a harp player. He played the harp. Why? Because it drove away evil spirits. Rudy, hit that chimes over there. That's about the closest thing. Yeah, the chimes. That's the closest thing we got to a harp. So you hear that. You know, that's the harp. Keep hitting it. Keep hitting it. I'm sorry. And so you hear that. And so Saul used to have him playing that all the time. Why? because it was driving away the evil spirits. Now let me tell you, all right, you can stop. Let me tell you about us. This is what we would do. 20 years from now, guess what we will still be doing? Playing that harp. You know why? Because God anointed me to play that harp. God anointed me to drive the king away. I mean, the spirits of the king away. And you know what we would have been for the rest of our lives? Harp players for the king. But that's not what God designed us for. Just because of the season you're in now, you're playing the harp. Just because of the season that you're in now, God has you doing these different things. That's great. But what I'm here to tell you is move on from the harp. Yeah, move on from the harp. Because if David would have never moved on from the harp, he never would have killed Goliath. Understand that. He didn't just wake up one day to play the harp. He was also a shepherd. So in his spare time, what did he do? Learn how to play the harp. If you don't maximize your time, you will always be one-dimensional.
Come on.
In your spare time, you have to diversify. If you don't diversify and learn more gifts in God, you will always be stagnant. That's why it's not about the gift. Number two, does God see you how you see you? Because you know how we see ourselves. We see ourselves as almighty. I'm baptized in the name, filled with the Holy Ghost. I'm pristine. You know how we see ourselves. We see ourselves with no flaws. We see ourselves with no fallacies. We see ourselves as, I'm a Christian. I've been saved my whole life. But how does God see you? I'm here to tell you right now, saint. God see you all. Some of you, maybe even most of you. How do you see me right now? Because if I told you, I know my wife, I like using my own family, so that way don't nobody else feel bad. If I told my wife right now, I say, hey, baby, let's go. You're going to say, where we going? Hey, let's go to this 5-star restaurant. She's going to be like, okay.
That's about you, old chunks.
Now, we ain't invite no walls.
It's only one of them.
Oh, yeah, you can come.
Everybody else gone.
But if I told her that, you know what she's going to say next? She's going to say, I know how I'm dressed. But are you going to go change? And you know what I'm going to tell her? I'm the captain. See how that works? I'm the captain. You know, what's wrong with what I got on? Listen. I got on Nautica. You understand what I'm saying? I got Nautica. You look at my little shoes. I don't know what they are, but I'm going to just say they're some Tom Fords. That's what I'm going to say. I got on some Tom Fords. You understand what I'm saying? I got on some True Religion jeans. What you mean? And you know what she's going to say? That may be true, but the way you look is horrible. Your clothes wrinkled up, jeans got holes all in them. I got on black ankle socks, intentionally didn't put no lotion on my legs.
But you can pay for your meal.
If I can get there. You understand what I'm saying? How do God see us?
Right.
How do God see us? Because how I see myself, I'm okay. But I know my wife. She's going to say, okay, let's go out and eat. She's going to say, okay. She say, I'm going to drive. Her driving already is sign number one. There's a problem. I already know we ain't making it to San Diego. I don't know where we're going, but it ain't San Diego. 9 times out of 10, at best, we're going to pull in the Panda Express. Drive through. Because one thing she ain't going to do, she going to get something to eat. That one, hey, I ain't going to deprive her of a meal. But I won't be with her. Why? Because I don't represent the standards of what it takes to be in a 5-star restaurant. Matter of fact, they wouldn't even let me in. Because someplace, at a minimum, you got to have on a jacket.
Right.
What am I saying to you, saints? I know I look crazy, but I want you to see me for me, because this is how God sees us. I don't know how you see you. You might see yourself perfect, but it doesn't matter how you see you. The only thing that matters is, how does God see you? Amen. That's why I look. And no matter what I say to you all, don't have on no belt, pad sagging. I feel uncomfortable too. I'm like, man, I need to put on a belt. But the point that I'm making is this. If I take off my shirt and just let my neighbor's shirt go, there are some places I might be able to go. But you know what they're going to say? Especially if I talk to my boys back there in the back, they're going to be like, Pastor, what's wrong with you? Man, what you doing? Man, I'm trying to be like y'all. I'm trying to be cool. No, Pastor, that don't work for you. No, Pastor, that's not you. How can you? You don't know me. How many of y'all have said that? You don't know where I'm from. You don't know what I'm about. That's totally irrelevant to how you look, though. I don't care where you're from. It's where you at. Right. That's all that really matters. It's where you at. And they're going to tell me, Pastor, you just don't fit in. You know why I don't fit in? Because my core doesn't fit in. And this is how we are. Just because you call yourself a Christian, you're not going to fit in everywhere. God didn't design you to fit in with every crowd. I know what Paul said. That to all things, that's what he became. That don't mean he looked like them. He just had the ability to relate to them. He wasn't walking around there. Look what I look like coming in here with 50 million tattoos. Stuff all on my neck and face. And I'm going to tell y'all, keep it real. I'm not telling you that a pastor can't look like that. But what I am saying to you is, why? Because if you wasn't raised that way, if you didn't have those tattoos before you got saved, if you didn't have that demeanor before you got saved, why are you trying to pick it up now? Just so I can draw some gangbangers in here? I'm telling you right now, if you can't preach Jesus and Jesus can't draw them, they just can't be drawn. It has to be the Jesus in you that draw people. Because all I will be doing is looking crazy. And let me tell you what kind of effect that'll have. I got two of the craziest sons you ever want to meet. My two young ones. Because all they're going to do is look at me and be like, Mom, Dad got 50 million tattoos. Can I get one? Yeah, that's how they think. I mean, I do have tattoos. I do. Y'all don't see them. You know, but I ain't getting no more. I had them before. You know, I did. I got one right here. So if I ever raise my hand up too high, you'll see it. I remember the first time my kids saw it. Dad, what's that, Dad? What you have? You got tattoos, Dad? I didn't know you had tattoos. I said, am I tattoos? They said, what are they? Birthmarks. Mom, Dad got two birthmarks. Where my birthmark at? Till they got old enough, they were like, Dad, that ain't no birthmarks. Okay. Understand how you was raised and what God did in your life and where he kept you from before you got saved. There is nothing you can do about that. Don't ever be ashamed of where you come from. Don't ever be ashamed of where God brought you from. But he brought you from there for a reason. He didn't bring you from there so you can stay there. We got to keep on moving. That's crazy. We trying to evolve to draw people, and all we need to do is what they did. Preach one Jesus. That's it. Who God made you, that's how you deliver the message. Number three, we almost done. Normal to you is crazy to others. You got to understand that, what that really means. Normal to you is crazy to others. Normal to you is crazy to others. Normal to you is crazy to us. Normal to you is crazy to others. You being crazy is not normal to others. That just makes you even crazier. And there's a difference. Here's the difference. At my job, they have social outings. At least 2-3 times in a month. And they always say, in front of, hey, Mr. Oliver, you gonna come? Yeah, nope. Why not? Because what time is it? Oh, it's at 1700, which is at 5 o'clock. Let me get this straight. Are y'all paying me? And he's like, no, I won't be there. Yeah, that's how that worked. So then they got smart. They started having the socials, doing working out. Hey, Mr. Oliver, we're having a social. What time is it? 2 o'clock, and you get the rest of the day off. You gonna be there? No. Why not? Because I know what y'all gonna be doing. You're just gonna be drinking and carrying on. You can't be part of that. No. Why not? Because y'all got Facebook. What you mean by Facebook? All I can see, me sitting there with a social, with a Coke in my hand. Mm-hmm. Y'all put me on Facebook.
Right.
Man, look at Pastor at the club with a rum and Coke.
Right.
What possessed you to think I got a rum and Coke? Mm-hmm. But you gonna say that. But you're going to be like, I knew it. I knew it. And guess what you're going to do? You're going to go get you some rum and Coke. Yeah, that's how that worked. I said, no, I don't do that. But here's the real reason why I don't do it. Because it's just not in me to do.
Right.
That's really what it boils down to. I'm not doing it because I'm not saved. Don't get me wrong. Because I'm saved, I don't do it.
Amen.
Understand the difference. Your natural ability is the reason why you don't do it. And the reason I say that is because some of us is saved right now and you doing some things you know you shouldn't be doing. I don't want to raise their hand on that one, but you know I'm telling the truth. So just because you saved don't mean you ain't going to do something. We was at church on Friday. Man, Rudy got a crash course. Rudy was playing up some on Friday though. Yeah, he made a difference, but he was like, hey, what's going on? And he was just playing. He was just playing. You know, he really was. But here's the thing. Even on that, there was a lot of things that was going on that we just didn't do. And it ain't because we are holier than thou. It's because that's just not my nature to do. When your nature, and remember we read it earlier, when your nature or your what? Manner is a part of you, then you don't have to use the excuse, I'm not going to do this because I'm not saved. Most of us use that as an escape goat. That means you really want to do it. I ain't going to do this because Jesus don't want me to do this. Because I love Jesus. Jesus would be frowning. When it was part of your nature, you wouldn't even have to say Jesus. That's just not my nature. Why is it not your nature? I used to do that job. God changed me. I just don't have no desire to do it. See how different that is? That's when you allow your lifestyle to draw them to Jesus. But if you, well, Jesus don't want me to dress like that. Jesus don't want me. Next time somebody tell you that, say, when the last time you talked to him? And can I get that number? You see how that works? And we try to use the scriptures. This is why a certain denomination, certain people, certain sect, people in life in general, this is where they come up with stuff. In order for you to, we used to be this group, and we used to call them the sanctified people in my neighborhood. And you know how they used to look? This is how they used to look. They used to walk around in these big old long skirts and with these white things on their head. Everybody looked like they know you belong to this church. I remember my wife them saw them for the first time. She said, what's wrong with them? Oh, they sanctified. You know why they look that way? You know why people tell you you can't wear this, you gotta look this way, you gotta look that? They use it under the disguise of, this is how holiness look, this is how righteousness look, this is how godly men and godly women look. But what they're really doing is using the scriptures to control you, to give you a certain image. But I'm telling you now, I don't care what image you have, if it's not on the inside of you, you still ain't gonna look right. There's a lifestyle with this calling. There's a lifestyle with this calling, saints. I don't care who you're going to be. There's a lifestyle. And that's where most of us fall. We don't want to live the lifestyle. Because the lifestyle means you got to put away some things. Lifestyle means you got to grow a little bit. And lifestyle means you just can't do what the flesh wants you to do. You know, that's the lifestyle. Lifestyle means I don't want to be associated with that. Yeah, that's what the lifestyle means. You know, I've seen people who have lived a certain lifestyle. And sometimes something bad, they say bad habits is hard to break. I'm going to give it to you according to the scriptures. And then we're going to close out. It says that Paul did what was in his manner, meaning that he always did it. And every town he went into, he went to the synagogue and he taught for 3 Sabbath days. So 3 Sabbath days means that's how many weeks? 3 weeks. So if you ever want to change your manner, if you ever want to change your habits, do something for 3 straight weeks. And it will become part of your mannerisms. Then you don't have to try not to do something. Pastor, you curse? No, I don't curse. Why you don't curse? Because Jesus don't want me to curse. Pastor, you cheat on your wife? No, I don't cheat on my wife. My wife wouldn't want me to cheat on her. What? You see how that really sounds? What you mean your wife wouldn't want? What about you? See, when something is in you, you listen. I used to do this in the military on a regular basis. I'm going to give y'all this, and y'all protect it for you. When the chief, my petty officer came to me and said, Petty Officer Oliver, I want you to tell the people to sweep the floors. You do? Yeah. Thank you. I'll run to the front. Hey, everybody get here. Y'all gonna sweep these floors right now. That ain't what they told me to say. But you know what I did? I gave that order like I'm giving it. Because I knew they already told me they want it done. What I look like saying, listen, y'all, Chief and HM1 want y'all to clean these floors. You know what I really just done? I just bypassed my own authority. That means anytime I want something done from that point on, if I don't say Chief or HM1, it'll never get done. Saints, that's the kind of authority that God has given us. We don't have to say, Jesus, no, you don't want to do that because it's wrong. Then they're going to say, prove that it's wrong. It's right here in the Bible.
Amen.
But most of us, no, we don't. Well, thou shalt not do this. That we, man, people don't want, they know what it says. They need to see some proof that it works. That's why marriages are struggling today. Because we got to show them proof that it works. Because if something works, that means you believe in it. And if you believe in it, you become part of it. Yes, Jesus did say it, but I got Jesus down on the inside, and I'm going to preach to you about that one Jesus, one Lord, one faith, one baptism,
amen,
and one God and Father of all. That's in me. I don't need to use the Bible as an excuse on why I don't do something. I don't do it because it's in me not to do. I'm not going to go on a double date with another man, not because it's going to offend my wife. I already know it's going to offend her. It just ain't in me to do. And because I stand on those principles, that's what's going to draw people to me to say, hey, well, how did you get that way? Then I can tell them, because of the God that I serve. Do you understand that Jesus, the Bible says that the fame of Jesus, it didn't go out because he was talking about his father. That ain't caused the fame of Jesus to go out. The fame of Jesus didn't go out because he said, I am that I am. I'm the King of Kings, Lord. The fame of Jesus didn't go out because of it. The fame of Jesus went out because of the way he healed people. The fame of Jesus went out because he turned 2 loaves, 5 loaves, and 2 fish. And fed 5,000 one time and 3,000 the next. The fame of Jesus went out because he healed the sick and he raised the dead. The fame of Jesus went out because he made the blind see. If you want fame, do some work. And if you can do it in Jesus' name, then he started telling them, I can do what I do because of my Father. My Father and I are one. That's what he did. We want to tell them the Father is one, and we don't even have no proof. How I know you saved?
Well, I got baptized. I got filled with it.
That's great. That was then. What about today? What have you done for me lately? That's the kind of God we serve. Let us stand. Saints, point number 5 for y'all that's writing it down. It has to always be Jesus over you. That's point number 5. It has to be Jesus over you. We just make some, you ever walked into somebody's office and they got Bibles up? Oh, man, got Bibles all everywhere, crosses all on them. So you look at them, ooh, praise Jesus. How you doing today? Oh, I am blessed. I'm highly favored. God died on the cross for me today, and that gave me the reason to live. Wait, what? I just asked you how you was doing. Well, because he was born and rose on the 3rd day, I'm able to do the things that I'm able to do. God has blessed me in my health and my strength. I promise you, I'll never ask you how you're doing again. A simply fine would suffice. But that's what we do. Because we think if we say all of those things, that's going to let people know how our spirituality is. If I wear my Jesus freak t-shirts and my Jesus bandanas, that's going to make people think I serve Christ. If I get my car plastered in fish and Jesus and all this other stuff, then guess what? That's going to let people know I love the Lord. I'm here to tell you, I don't do it. And the reason I don't do it, because that lowers the turning value of the car. That's what that means. But here's what I'm going to say to you, though. If that's who you are, you put as many Jesus tattoo stickers on your car as you want. You want to know why? Because if that's who you are, people are going to know that's who you are. That's the best part about it. Don't do stuff because of what you think it's going to bring. You do stuff because it's in you to do. And because God made each and every one of us different, people are going to look at you strange. They're going to tell you, it don't take all of that. But they don't know you. Now you can say, you don't know me. You don't know where he brought me from. It takes this and a whole lot more. It's going to take more than crazy for me to make it to heaven. Because if you think I'm crazy now, wait till I start walking in the fullness of his promises. If you think something is wrong with me now, wait till I start walking in the fullness of the glory. If you think I am crazy now, wait until I understand how to be with Christ is gain. I'm learning. Wait till I walk in the fullness of his glory. Oh, you really think I'm crazy then? Because I live for him. And I'm telling you, I don't want y'all to say this if you don't mean, but I'm telling you right now, I know for a fact, I'll die for Christ. Amen. Too many things in my life, they done gave me an ultimatum on. Elder Wong Chong and I was on the ship together. And the head chaplain said, hey, you can't teach and preach in his name. You better write me up or cancel our services. Because I can't change that. That's who I am. And I didn't. I done been to army ceremonies. When I pray in Jesus' name.
That's right.
That is in me. I can't change that. So whatever repercussions that brings, I'm willing to accept that. But the one thing I know is this. If I'm doing it, and I'm doing it in his name, and I'm doing it in his favor, he got me.
Come on now. Man.
That's what I know. If you think I'm crazy now, if you think I'm not wrapped tight now, If you think I got mental issues now, you haven't seen nothing yet. Because the more and more I'm learning to trust in him, the more and more I'm putting my faith in him, then I ain't gonna need this captain hat to say I'm a captain. Somebody else gonna say I'm a captain. See, it ain't about what you say about yourself. It's what other people say. You know how I know? Because the king looked at Pontius Pilate, looked Jesus dead in the eye. And he said, are you the king of kings? Are you the king of the Jews? Did Jesus say, yes, I'm the king of the Jews? No. You know what he said? If that's what you say. If that's what you say. Because if somebody else said it, they said it for a reason. If you said it, you might be lying or bragging. Let somebody else say it about you. Yeah, parents, we're supposed to instill values in our children. But if mom and dad say you're beautiful or you're handsome, they believe it, but you know how that works. Yeah, that's mom and dad, you're supposed to say that. But let 6'5", 36, 24, 36 say, you handsome. That 6'5", 2% body fat. Oh, you beautiful. I be seeing it in my daughters. They be walking through the house different. Like, wait, what's wrong with you?
Nothing.
Be in the mirror all day tonight. I go to my wife. Hey, they got a boyfriend. They ain't told me. What you mean they ain't told you? You see what I see? Some boy done told them they look good. They fixing themselves up. Dad say you look good. Mom say you handsome. Oh, well, thank you. I love you too. That's human nature. All of us want to be appreciated. All of us want compliments. But don't give them to yourself. Let God do it.